True anxiety until you're driving a car worth $1 million, the only one of its kind in the entire country, down a busy suburban road with trams, pedestrians, and a road Camry driver veering dangerously close to its exquisite paintwork. The weight of responsibility I felt in this situation could only possibly be outdone by the curb weight of the car I was driving, the 2021 Rolls-Royce Ghost Extended. As long wheelbase version of Rolls's famous swanky sedan, the Ghost Extended measures 17 centimeters longer than its forebear and adds an extra $122,000 before on-road costs to the price tag. In fact, as tested, the car I spent a day navigating down some of Melbourne's most congested and potholed roads clocked in at $992,784 before on-road costs were even factored in. While my job lands me in some pretty fancy cars, it's safe to say I've never come close to the realm of what is arguably the world's most iconic and expensive luxury car maker. So, when the call came to spend a day with the Ghost Extended, I said yes without hesitation, despite immediately developing sweaty palms at the thought. Although it looks like a gentle giant, there's a booming 6.75-liter twin-turbo V12 engine under the bonnet capable of producing a peak of 420 kilowatts and 850 newton-meters. I'd count those impressive outputs as my first surprise in what became a day of unexpected revelations about a car I'd long presumed would be old-worldy, stuffy, and incredibly intimidating to drive. 2021 Rolls-Royce Ghost Extended. Engine 6.75-liter V12 twin-turbo. Power and torque 420 kilowatts at 5,000 revolutions per minute, 850 newton-meters at 1,600 revolutions per minute. Transmission 8-speed automatic. Drive type all-wheel drive. Curb weight 2,599 kilograms. Fuel claim combined 15.3 to 15.7 liters / 100 kilometers. Boot volume 500 liters. Turning circle 13.6 meters. ANCAP safety rating untested. Warranty 4 years, unlimited km. Main competitors Bentley Flying Spur, Mercedes-Maybach S-Class. Price as tested $992,784 before on-road costs. The surprises from the new Macan collection, upstairs at the Rolls-Royce dealership on Melbourne's Swan Street, an airy, light-filled space occupied by a small handful of classic and new rollers and one man, Christopher Hope, brand manager of Rolls-Royce Motor Cars Melbourne and the sole dealership salesperson. Chris was possibly the biggest surprise of all, a beautifully outfitted lover of finer things who immediately told me to relax and breathe, and proceeded to share anecdotes about how he'd match leather seats to designer handbag colors, offered strangers on the street the chance to sit in the back seat, or asked prospective buyers to take their shoes off to feel the lamb school floor mats under their toes. More on that later. Stuffy and old-worldy, this was not. Immediately put at ease by Chris's apparent imperviousness to the sheer value of the vehicles around us, I started to relax into the Rolls-Royce ownership experience. It's a tough gig, but someone's gotta endure it. It starts the morning of, at about 8 a.m., I send a text message that says no more sleeps. He excitedly told me of the handover process. From there, owners come into the showroom, where they're met with a glass of whiskey or freshly made coffee. Floor-to-ceiling curtain guarding the new arrival. In the case of the Ghost Extended off of the car advice, the process kicked off roughly 8 months prior, when a buyer contacted Chris during the height of the COVID-19 outbreak and placed an order for an example of everything. The car on test was in a shade of bohemian red, with a cashmere gray and black interior, 21-inch twin-spoke part polished wheels and chrome-plated visible exhausts. Inside, the new car smell is subtle, like the faint scent of extremely good quality leather and $100 bills, I'm only kidding about that second one. The interior is a visual feast, and it's hard to know what to highlight. Perhaps the dedicated champagne fridge in the rear? The Starliner roof complete with shooting stars? The doors that self-close with the touch of a button? For me, the biggest draw card was the lamp's full floor mats, the softest, most wildly impractical display of luxury I've seen in a car in some time. Out among the general public, the ghost extended certainly attracted some special reactions. Hilariously, we chose to conduct some of our filming and test driving in one of Melbourne's most affluent suburbs, meaning the reactions tended to lean more towards "Oh, my granddad has one of those," rather than "Wow." We did, however, experience a particularly special moment when a 7-year-old said in hushed tones to his group of school friends, "Look, that's a Rolls Royce." Out on the road, I expected myself to feel very chastened and awed behind the wheel, but what I didn't expect was the general reverence the ghost extended attracted from other drivers. From admiration to avoidance, it seemed few were immune to the universal allure of a very, very expensive car. And few dared to come close to it, lest they scrap it and be $10,000 out of pocket. Another surprise came courtesy of the gear stick, which is actually a thoroughly modern gear selector stuck on the steering wheel, much like the ones on Mercedes-Benz cars. Unlike Mercedes's version, however, the Rolls maintains the old-fashioned column shift action of pulling the selector towards you between the tents, so you can't accidentally pop the car into neutral if you go to indicate on the wrong side. The Ghost was already a large car, but the extended wheelbase has brought it to just over 5.7 meters in length. I was surprised to find its size didn't feel all that mammoth on the road. This was thanks in part to excellent cameras and parking sensors, which can act as your eyes and zero in on curbs or tight parking spots, but also thanks to the surprisingly light steering. In fact, I could have used a bit more steering feel and feedback at lower speeds, as I found it difficult to gauge the level of input required to take corners, something that improved at freeway speeds, with the all-wheel steering adding another layer of dynamism above 80 kilometers per hour. A 13.6 meters turning circle will see most 2 turns become 3-point turns, and plenty of parking spaces will be immediately ruled out, although a parking assistant can handle that particular chore for you if you so wish. Ride comfort is exemplary, speed bumps are all but cancelled out, and it genuinely feels as though there's a layer of cloud between you and the road at all times. Out on the freeway, it's as though the world is on mute. While you can hear the faint whooshing noise of passing cars, everything else is demurred, from the vibration of the engine, to tire noise, to even the exhaust when you accelerate. Gone, too, is the telltale rumble or growl of a V12 engine, something prospective buyers could see as a downside. The potential brawn is more of a well-kept secret between car and owner than a show of head-turning bravado. Although you can feel all that accessible power lingering under the surface, the way it's delivered through the 8-speed auto is so even, linear and silent, you can transition from 60 km per hour to 100 km per hour without any perceptible gear shifts. This ability to shut out the intrusions of the outside world, paired with the surprisingly functional, user-friendly dashboard, can have you forgetting you're driving a car with a serious reputation and price tag. And finally, while I loved the lamp's wool carpet as a passenger, as a driver it proved slippery and caused the heel of my boot to slide a few times when accelerating and braking. After a morning of around town driving in plenty of traffic, the car's trip computer was showing an average real-world fuel consumption figure of 20.0 liters/100 kilometers. That might sound high, but consider this is a huge car and the quoted consumption on a combined cycle of driving is 15.3 to 15.7 liters/100 kilometers. I'd imagine a bit more time in the car, with some freeway driving in the mix, could have brought that real-world figure more in line with the quoted number. For many,